Okay, let's go.
Yeah,
so this one is, it will be a session on deploying Xamarin with the Chocolaty and Bookstarter. They're basically open source tools. I'll go further into that in a few seconds. Very quickly, my name is Julien. I'm a French consultant. I'm doing tons of stuff with NCR and XenApp, application delivery, and very recently cloud, AWS and Azure. And this session will be about kind of bringing value and deploying apps and infrastructure into the cloud, onto the cloud cloud deployments. What I learned hard way is that basically tons of things that I've been doing for years now on-prem simply don't apply anymore in the cloud, right? Especially when it comes to application delivery. For very few reasons. We all do XenApp or PBS and MCS, and we're spinning boxes with MDT, and simply all those things don't work anymore in the cloud. And I had a real challenge because I had some customers with tons of applications, and I had no means to deploy them automatically on the cloud hosted XenApps, right? So, well, you know, Microsoft kind of from here till maybe till last year didn't move so much, right, when it comes to helping us deploy stuff on servers, right? I mean, at one point, you know, OSD and all operating system deployments and ESD are kind of pretty much the same for the last 25 years. And this kind of sucks. Sucks really much because when you need to do stuff granularly, like in the cloud, you know, having repeatable deployment that you can rerun every time your auto scale and things like that, well, this model doesn't work anymore, right? So I had a missing puzzle down there, you know, I didn't know how to address it. I started Googling and I find about a project called Chocolaty.org. It's basically open source stuff. If you Google to it, you'll find tons of applications that you can simply, from a command line perspective, just reinstall and get over with in a few seconds. And basically all those guys, which are probably 95% of them are our customers, or maybe the customers, unsatisfied customers, they move to the cloud. They came in, they spin up the boxes in the cloud in 15 seconds, something that we can very rarely achieve on-prem. And then they said, okay, cool, I have a box, how they put content to it, right? All these testing machines, development machines and stuff like that. You need Java, you need Eclipse, you need tons of stuff, right? And well, they develop stuff. They develop the things they know, something like an apt-get in the Linux world, but for Windows. Something to manage dependencies and kind of make repeatable deployments much more easier, right? And basically, the things that we cannot do anymore, like we did previously, are kind of SSCM and equivalents when it comes to cloud. What I said previously, we need more repeatable deployments. I will go fast forward into that. Better dependency management works for servers, something that will work the same way for servers and desktops, right? And providing at the end an application infrastructure self-service in a way, right? And a product like that, honestly, I didn't see so many products on the market doing exactly that, right? Giving that much flexibility to admins when it comes to the cloud, right? So probably the reason for that is that today on the cloud side, I mean, the things are going, and I think there are some things we can call native cloud deployments. All those open source guys kicking into AWS, and they know their stuff, and it's built for that. And Windows is emerging very slowly, right? And probably this is one of the reasons that we still lack this set of tools. So we are, at this point, in my opinion, we need to deploy them and create them ourselves. So we'll get to that in a few seconds. So basically, what I will be using today for this presentation is three things, right? A box starter, a chocolate nugget, and a PowerShell. I'll detail every element that is on the slide. Basically, Chocolaty is a client using something we call a nugget specification. For those who do Visual Studio, this is basically a DLL you'll be supported by IIS. We have it for ages available, but there you using exactly the same technology, but in another way, right? While in Visual Studio, we can follow the DLL dependency and stuff. They are doing the same thing, but on the application level. And Chocolaty is basically a client that will go connect to a remote service, which can be cloud-hosted or on-prem, where you have a package definitions, and get that, download that, execute that, install the stuff, right? I will do a live demo because I hate PowerPoint, so I will go very, very, going really fast to that. And this cloud service is called MyGet. MyGet is basically an application. You don't have any obligation of using it if you go to chocolaty.starterworld, right? You can use, you can install your own IIS from Visual Studio, export it, and have your own nugget privately hosted. There are some applications based on that which are available free of charge. Or you can go to a cloud hosted service, which is kind of cool because basically it's free of charge, and if you want to have a private repository, it's something like €7 a month, and it's a really brilliant application. I'll show you later. So these are the stuff we'll be using today. So in detail, Chocolaty great. Chocolaty.org is a really great stuff. This community site I've been talking about half a minute ago. Sorry?
I kind of feel we need a version of that with Carl and his ginger beer.
Yeah.
No, I disagree.
You do? The stuff is really great, but I mean, really not meant for business because it's kind of everybody can contribute and create packages. And the way it works on Chocolaty.org, right, is that you'll go there, for example, or you want to go do a Chrome. Your Chocolaty client will go connect to the repository, which is Chocolaty.org, read the package and say, okay, I'll go and fetch the Chrome from the Google servers, right? This is fine when you're at home. This simply can't happen when you're in the enterprise, right? So in the enterprise-type deployments, this thing cannot work, right? Lack of packaging standards because there's hundreds of people contributing, so there is absolutely no, you can't find three packages that are the same, some don't even work, right? There is no binary control if you want to package a virus. I mean, why not? This can work, right? As well. And of course, there is no software which requires a license. So if you want to do Office, Chocolaty.org, simply you can't do it because it's not legal, right? So basically, I said, okay, this kind of looks cool. Pure PowerShell. The guys are basically taking this Chocolaty client, which is nothing more, nothing less of a PowerShell, partial script, is basically reading the configuration file online, and then going fetching files here and there. I said, if I could do the same thing and kind of fetch my binaries locally and make a kind of standard way to package those applications, maybe this could work, right? And this is what I try to do. So basically, I'm using Chocolaty like private repository, right, where I have my own packages, which is protected. Nobody can access to that. And I'm using my local NAS for my binaries. First of all, it's much faster because I'm kind of using my local stuff instead of downloading every single time stuff from the internet. Second thing, it's local, so I mean, I can control it. And I'm the one who is putting binaries here and there. My second thing, which I achieved in this way, is that I wanted to make my packages kind of portable, right? Because I'm a consultant, I'm going from a client to a client. So if every time I make a package, I need to open it up and readapt it to another client, it would be a mess, right? It would be a huge work, and I could kind of make mistakes, and user experience wouldn't be great. So this was another thing that I wanted to achieve. As I said, on-prem storage for binaries, and it works basically in an apt-get with Windows 9. And the third thing, which you rarely encounter, basically, when you install 7-zip in Chrome, and that, I mean, enterprise class packages, they sometimes require a reboot, and Chocolaty cannot handle it. So basically, whatever the reboot is there, well, machine will just reboot, and if there is something behind that, it will fail, right? And this is why there is a second product called Bookstarter, which is basically a pilot plane for Chocolaty, making it reboot resilient, and we'll get to that in a few seconds, right? And of course, we can manage software dependencies with that, which is kind of really cool. For those who are trying to package vSphere, they know, I mean, how many stuff are bundled into that XE. It's a really, really messy. And I'm lucky at Dennis because he was the first one I had it in front of me. So, or other stuff, right, that require VDA agent, for example, with all this Visual Studio 2005, 2008 dependencies that you need to have before installing it. So basically now you can really describe it, have it in your package definition. So this is how it looks like, for real. Basically, a shortcut package, this one will install Core Shell. What I try to make with this code is to make sure that every time I change the client, I don't need to go and change every single thing inside of this thing. So basically, what I'm using is a system variable I'm calling destination, or basically, I'm setting that in my as a system variable, which is importing this to my NAS, and then the vendor product version and package name structure is basically included. So this part is really generic, right? So when I'm kind of running the code, I will kind of go and say, okay, I want to install something that you will find in a Shockwave repository, then Microsoft PowerShell 4.0, and the package name would be KB, whatever, MSU. I'm choosing this package deliberately for a very simple reason, is that this is an MSU package, and the Chocolati basically today is supporting, only MSP and Exis. But I mean, this is what Chocolati Engine can manage. There's tons of things you can do aside of that. So typically you can do MSU, you can do plain PowerShell. We'll see that in a few seconds. So this would be a package that will install basically a PowerShell onto server, right? When I said a box starter, in this example here, you will see something that basically the installation logic is required to install a XenApp server from scratch, right? We need to install, we don't see the first line, which is basically remote desktop host role that is being installed. And then we'll go with all these kind of features. Some of them are mandatory, some of them are not, right? Some dependencies, you'll go and install a VDA, and you would install the applications. At the end, you would configure a VDA. This is the logic behind that. So I will try to show you that live. I'll give it a few seconds. Okay. This is basically a repository. As you can see, we are live on my lab. All of those packages, if you see the size, are extremely small. So for example, a 4K package, 19K Citrix receiver, 4K control app. I think I have a Uber agent somewhere there. And there is a thing that we'll be installing today called E2E worker, right? There's absolutely no limitations on what can be installed here. I'm having Office in my repository, a KeePass, a GRE, IIS, even SQL 2014, some hot fixes for Citrix. Basically, the whole thing is that splitting the infrastructure in small pieces, small chunks, and then calling it from a centralized script, right, and bringing those pieces together, constructing the whole environment in a single click. And of course, which is really cool, it's completely free of charge. It's kind of open source. So basically here, there are some basic scripts that will create delivery group of whole farm, install a XenApp, migrate apps from farm to another, etc., etc., etc. So in order to do all of that, the server we'll be using today is basically a 2012 R2 box. It's running in my lab.
Password one.
Yeah. So you saw it was kind of really fast. There is no Atlantis guy, so I can say there is an USX on the backend, so this is why it takes a few seconds to open a session. As you can see, I mean, there is absolutely nothing in this box. It's a vanilla stuff, right? This is something that comes with my image This is running on the VMware ESX55, right? So this is my kind of template, a regular template for a standard server. It's absolutely nothing in an antivirus, VMware tools, and 2008, few Visual C redistributables, right? So this is what we have here. So the packages will be running today. I have them stored on my desktop. Yeah. This would be right. This is a scripting logic behind them. So basically, the package will be running today. Will be and yeah, this is the one. E3 worker. So the first thing we'll be doing, we'll be installing app server role, meaning RDS host role to the server, and then we'll be basically using a native Chocolaty installation logics, which allows us to install features natively, right? And then once that sequence is done, if reboots are necessary, box starter will handle that. Every time he catches a reboot pending, he will reboot the machine and continue on once the machine is up and running. And further on, we will install Xena VDA. Once the VDA is installed, we'll kind of install a hotfix stem for the VDA 7.6. And then we'll install some applications, 7-zip admin tools, controller, Uber agent, OpenSSL, Office 2013, etc., etc. And once that thing is done, we'll run a Xenap config in order to attach basically this box to a specific delivery group. Right? And the only way I find this kind of, I wanted to make this really generic and really easy to modify for people, right? Because okay, if I would be hard coding everything into it, right? Tomorrow I need to change a delivery group, you need to open up all the packages, it kind of sucks. I use basically a very similar approach as you guys did with your product. I'm having an external file, for example, where I'm specifying my broker. I will be using delivery group name and the machine catalog I will be using, right? So, which allows my script to be completely generic. And tomorrow, if I would need to change the farm, my delivery group, my catalog, I will just change the text file, and everything would be up and running in a few seconds. And why I'm doing this, because basically this script, which is joining a VDA to a farm, is composed of very generic blocks, meaning that I'm using the same thing, right? The same logics. My partial script will be somewhere in, on the NAS, and probably here, where I have absolutely so basically, this is the thing we'll be catching at the beginning. Chocolaty, Citrix, Posh. This is the one we'll be looking for. Xenap config. Basically, this is the file we'll be executing from the PowerShell and reading variables from this text file. Right. So, as I said, completely generic from this perspective. Absolutely nothing to add inside. So basically, in this phase of the script, I will be kind of parsing my text file, catching my variables I will be using further on. Using some local variables, right, which will kind of set my, trying to catch my server name I'm running on. And I'll be using the script blocks to remotely connect to a broker, right, to get the broker GUI, which I need further on to install Xenap. Right, so to configure, sorry, the machine. So basically, nothing fancy, really, really simple stuff. And of course, you will find here the command I will be executing. So you'll have one required to add the catalog, machine to the catalog, and one required doing the same thing, adding machine to delivery group, right? With some really basic checks. And at the end of the script, I will be adding this box to a maintenance mode, right? In order to to give the control to administrator, kind of to check if everything went okay, to see the logs, if everything's okay, machine is production ready, just turn it off from the maintenance mode, and you're up and running, right? So this is the config file, and then as I show you a couple of seconds ago, there are tons of applications here, right? 7-zip admin tools and stuff like that. I want to show you how easy it is to package them. I'll show you, for example, a script installing a Google Chrome. Like, basically, this is all what it is. I will be taking a Chrome exe, right? Chrome exe, putting the Chrome exe somewhere in my repository, expecting this specification, my vendor product version, right? And quiet no restart are the basically silent arguments I will be using to install the Chrome. And I will just call a native Chocolaty provider, which is installing stuff, right? Install Chocolaty package, package name, installer type, unattended arguments, and destination. And that's all. So meaning that tomorrow, Google Chrome goes to the version 43.0. I will download this stuff, create a 43.0 on my NAS, change the version here, and we're up and running. 5 seconds, and we're good to go. So this would be a really native stuff that Chocolaty is doing pretty well, right? Everything you see aside there is completely custom, and I was going around the limitations, right, and pushing the product really to. So the things that probably I spoke with Rob, who kind of Robin and Rob Reynolds, who coded this for the Chocolaty community. They didn't even imagine that somebody were using this to install infrastructure one day. So, but hey, it's a pure PowerShell, so why not? So this is exactly what I said a couple of seconds ago. This is a script, the one here, that will be kind of installing Xenap, right? Installing Xenap, basically configuring a vanilla VDA into a specified delivery group, right? So as you see, very simple stuff. I'm just running a PowerShell exe execution policy on a restricted file and running my PowerShell script, and that's all. So let's stop talking. I will kind of run this right away. I think my credential has expired, so I will be using a mode in which I'm connected to this local Xenap server and running installation remote machine. So I will need a cred SSP, right? So this is exactly what I'll be doing. So I have my credentials now, and we'll specify. So we'll say, no, this is not a good one. This one as well. 5 seconds, install. Yeah. Okay, so that's better. So this is basically the syntax to install the full Xenap box with Chocolaty in Boxstars. So install Boxstars package, package name. I think we call it E2E worker. Once we have that, we'll say, install it to the computer called XusFWP05. Using my credentials, we specified a couple of seconds ago, $cred. And that's it. So basically, what is happening now is that the box starter will be testing if there is a reboot pending on the box, will test initial connectivity, and once it's done, he'll start. He will go to my repository, take the package, start reading it, and going line by line with what is written inside. And basically, this is exactly what is happening. So the first task will be installing APP server, meaning installing the RDP row. This will take a few seconds now, maybe 30, 40 seconds. And once that's done, you'll see the machine going to reboot. So this is normally where Chocolaty logics breaks, right? And this is the reason why I'm going over Chocolaty with this kind of environment called Box Starter, which is basically just a provider for Chocolaty, allowing to be reboot resilient. And this is exactly what I think. Yeah, this is. It took 32 seconds to install. Package RDS required reboot. Machine is being rebooted, and the Box Starter is waiting for machine to come back. And continue installation immediately when it's up. So do you guys have any questions? I know I try to be very fast, to go very fast into the presentation, because I know you must be tired and want to take some beers.
How does it work in distributed environments when you have different locations and so on?
Different locations, meaning?
Different data centers, for example, with multiple locations.
No, this is basically just a PowerShell, right? So, I mean, you would probably, if you, I mean, I would keep my binaries local to my data center, right? And with the variable, I would kind of try to fetch the data center I'm using and kind of orient my build from there. You have seen there in my initial installation command. Yeah, what happened?
It's a DS server rebooting, isn't it?
Yeah, I think my Mac rebooted. No, it isn't.
It's fine.
So basically, I think we're good now. He will install the features, and he's doing it right now as we speak. DNS server tools, right? He kind of got the information, the APP server is already installed, and he's going down the script, right? And you will see he will install DNS tools, and then he will go further on. If my Wi-Fi is still okay, let me see. It is.
That looks good.
It does. So I'm installing AD tools, etc., etc.
The question aimed more if the customer has, let's say, two data centers.
Right.
So the question is, of course, you can use one single repository, yeah. But if you distribute the content of the packages to, I don't know, one lines or something like this, it's probably a little bit slow or inefficient or whatever. So it would probably make sense to have a repository in each location. But if you
your repository are basically the binaries, right? The repository, the central one is a cloud-based, right? So what I would do, basically, I would kind of have a system replicating my binaries on both ends, right? And then kind of, but this is a pure scripting logic, isn't it?
Yeah, okay, so it does not have a replication.
This is not a product. This is a pure PowerShell, right? I mean, this
That's
is not a, no, this is definitely not a product. There is no vendor behind that. This is a community project. Nothing more, nothing else, right? Allowing you to do some really cool stuff, and I mean, the only limitation is your imagination, right? So we're kind of installing desktop experience while we're chatting. There will be another reboot, and then the VDA installation will kick in. Once that's done, we'll kick in the software installations, and at the end, of course, will be a config, please.
Are you sharing your own security package somewhere?
I will. This is the question I'm getting all the time. It will be shared very, very soon. I'm working with Derek, and
his secretary.
Yeah.
I don't have
a blog at one because I'm too lazy to write. But this will change in time.
That's very honest.
Yeah. I will try to publish all of these things somewhere because, as you can see, there are really tons of work here. Basically, the line you saw, like install. Install E2E worker. If I did run a package, if I ran a package, install Zenup farm, for example, XA farm build, well, basically, we could build a whole farm in a single click, meaning that here I have a text file I'm using to describe my farm, right? So I will change my SQL name, my database's name, etc., 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 and one click, the farm is being built. Like, why? Because I really wanted to avoid at all costs that the installation logics, meaning the PowerShell script that is really doing stuff, is being modified every time you go and see another customer. So basically, the script that will be installing, creating a farm on the way you like it, is kind of here. Right? I will be creating databases. I will be creating sites. I will be specifying licensing. I will say, okay, accept my certificate, so it will be cool that kind of I can connect to it. Adding the admins in a farm, configure an XML port to it, and basically that's it. So absolutely every single thing, every single piece of code you have in PowerShell is eligible to be deployed, I mean, ran by Chocolaty, right? And this is especially really, really cool in a cloud when you don't have anything other than that. So I think he did install desktop experience, and we're waiting for the machine to respond remotely, right? And especially because those customers going to cloud, they don't want SSTM stuff anymore. They want to keep it really, really inexpensive, and they want auto scale. So if you want auto scale, meaning you cannot do imaging, I mean, you cannot do imaging, yes, you can, but I mean, the effort of doing imaging is huge, right? Bootstrapping makes much more sense because technically I would just go and, I don't know, change a single line in one of my scripts and change crop to 42 to 43, take me 3 seconds and a half instead of respinning the whole image. Aside from the fact that doing imaging in AWS is really, really hard. I tried it and it's really not cool, especially multiple sites where images won't have the same IDs, AMIs and stuff. I mean, I would definitely advise kind of spinning the native AMIs because they will be patched when you do that and they are changing all the time. Amazon is doing a great work on that. And then just use something like this, operated by CloudFormation, that will just call Chocolaty and do stuff. I do the same thing on Hyper-V, for example. I'm spinning machines to that, creating machines. I will be writing a module allowing to create machine and bootstrap it directly on the vSphere, on the ESX as well. And basically, this is the logic behind it. So as you can see now, the system knows what is being installed, right? So it will take a few seconds to check all of those. And once it's done, we'll continue with the VDI installation phase.
Do you have any plans on building a GUI around it or something like that?
This is a great question. I don't know, honestly. I meant this for admins, right? Building a GUI around it would be a good idea, definitely. But I honestly, I'm really, really bad at C#. So I need a really good developer for that.
Yeah, sure.
So I prefer not doing something that doesn't look that bad, instead of doing something really basic, right?
But there will be also a session of your colleague in Berlin as well.
Basically, Roman works with me, and I think he'll be presenting something very similar similar to this. Basically, there are two or three of us working on that. It is very, very easy to get a GUI on top of that. Especially if you see that once you have your clients installed, right? In order to, for example, query what is available, it's kind of really simple. For example, if you want to know what is available in your store, you'll say that there is a native command called chocolist, right? While the machine is working. And what this thing will do is basically query my private repository for all the packages that are around. So yes, we are working on a GUI, but it's more best desktop based, allowing the self user installations right on the desktops. We want to do something like app store stuff, because I know what is installed. I know when it's a delta between a machine and my store, so I could send you like an Apple, right, the small icon with the one saying, oh, this application is there and can be updated, because the commands I'll be using in my scripts are basically Choco install since. There is also the way to uninstall the stuff you installed, Choco CU inst, and there is a Choco update, meaning that you can update boxes on a massive scale. So, for example, if I would want to install, say, a VLC or I don't know, or Director or SQL 2014 on 50 machines, instead of specifying a computer name, I could specify a list and go and install the stuff on 50 boxes in a few seconds, right? Today, I'm also having a stuff, the package that will set up the full mirroring environment, right? For Xen Desktop. I mean, I will basically connect to the SQL, do the stuff, connect to the broker, and tell him, hey, you know what? We're in the mirroring setup now. Please.
When you're building a package from scratch, they already exist as Chocolaty package on their official repository.
Yeah.
Can you download like the binary, the script file, open it, and then you modify
absolutely
it for the enterprise? Is that
you
what
know
you're
what? Absolutely, you can. And I will show you how does it look like. As you can see on the repo, a regular package has something like 4K. So if we open, for example, a XA farm build package, and okay, it is here. You can download it.
But that's your own repo. I mean the one, the official
absolutely
one.
Absolutely, you can.
Okay.
You can, but I mean, I would really advise you not to, because I mean, the way that those guys are packaging, it's really quick and dirty, right?
Yeah, that's why I want to modify it, because I have my own set of package and I'm using
absolutely
something quite similar.
Absolutely. Eric wrote a piece on his blog, right?
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen it.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, the way it's done and the way it's described in Eric's blog is exactly this logic behind it. I mean, I control the way the packages are being stored, deployed, called. I mean, it's really, really important.
Yeah,
otherwise,
it's super similar to what UPKG has been doing for years.
But basically, there's a free app called Nugget Package Explorer. You see the packages, this is the format, and you package, right? So if you open that, what we'll get here? Some metadata where you'll see who is the package owner, who worked on the package, the description, and the install, and basically the install stuff. So you will see here that inside the package, you will, what I showed you a couple of seconds ago, I mean, the package is this, right? This partial script. So there is not much there if you're calling partial from it. This is not required this way. Normal package you will find in the store would look much more like this, without all this variable stuff, because they go kind of, they're hitting there directly, right? But this is how this would look like. Probably with some basic testing in the applications installed, and if
yeah,
it is.
The hard part always remain like the installation of the application, the variable parts.
Yeah.
I can just copy what you did on one of your screens.
And this is,
just,
for example, if you can see on the Boxstyler shell, we are in the phase where installing Apache for a VDA, right?
Okay.
Please.
How do you compare it to MDT and VDA related WS?
MDT?
Yeah.
MDT, it's simply, you cannot compare it because it's one-shot stuff, right? MDT image with the applications for the initial build are fine. The problem you are having later is if you want to redeploy an application, and it is not a choice.
No.
So Microsoft will tell you, go SCCM. While here...
True. Sorry, it's not true. You can do it.
You can?
Yes.
With MDT?
Yes. But you cannot run it in the cloud, that's the problem. So
how would you do that?
You don't have layer 2 in Amazon. So
how would
you
do that with
MDT?
With MDT?
And
you don't have an MPT. Well, this is what you mean.
You can use a boot image.
You can do it afterwards when the Windows starts. Then you can come with MDT.
Yeah.
I think this is way more straightforward, but yeah.
But how do you get the Windows on it?
Sorry?
How do you get the Windows on the machine?
You can. I mean, as long as when you have a admin machine, right? From that admin machine, you can PowerShell into machine creation without any problem on Amazon. You can spin boxes
on
from
Amazon.
It.
What about Amazon?
Well, you could do the same thing with a PowerShell, can you? Okay, same as MDT.
I mean, this is okay, this is nice.
Yeah.
Really cool. But there are other tools, other free, who can do it.
I think the point is here, you can do everything with any tool,
yeah.
But this is already done. I mean, all the scripts
have
prepared it. So.
Yeah, but on the first one, is that SCCM can't do it and other tools can't do it as well. It's simply wrong.
Okay, I mean,
SCCM for sure not.
You don't have any management infrastructure here. That's a benefit.
SCCM is a bad thing because it's one of the worst tools.
MDT as well. You have a centralized server. I don't have anything here, right? I have a web-based cloud service where I have a small fraction of a package definitions and a binary, right? Completely plain infrastructure without any logics behind it.
Yeah,
no management,
nice.
Nothing, right?
Nice.
So, I mean, okay.
If you have any questions, please talk to Julian.
We have
no, I don't want to talk to the camera, okay?
All right.